When we were creating YouTube, I never thought that this would eventually be the favorite app my kids would be using, and I can tell them at 9 p.m. stop using my app when I want them to turn off YouTube.
Good local time, everyone, and welcome to Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. And today, I'm here with YouTube co-founder, Steve Chen. Good local time, everyone. Welcome to Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. It's a whole new series of video podcasts produced by TaiwanPlus, where I'll be talking with world-class thinkers to discuss the big ideas that are changing the world. To paraphrase Victor Hugo, the invasion of armies can be resisted, but some ideas, however, are irresistible. And if there's anything that seems irresistible nowadays, it's the rise of online video and streaming service. Chances are you're watching this TaiwanPlus show on YouTube right now. And YouTube has nearly 2 billion visitors a month and has undoubtedly changed the world profoundly. So today, I'm here with YouTube's co-founder, tech innovator, serial entrepreneur, Steve Chen. Steve has made many firsts in his life. He uploaded the very first cat video to YouTube in 2005. He received Taiwan's very first gold card in 2018, and he became the very first guest on our show, Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here.
Cool. Steve, as a co-founder of YouTube, my very first question is a simple one. How do you make a perfect cat video nowadays on YouTube?
As you know, when you're first developing a website as the first engineer, first developer, and CTO behind YouTube, it was always trying to upload videos onto YouTube to test the transcoding, to try to test the distribution, and just to test the platform, because we really were trying to kind of revolutionize using the internet as the back-end platform rather than TV and your cable channels for watching videos. So there were a lot of new things and new grounds we had to break. Many of the videos that we were uploading were just, that was within reach of a developer sitting at his home office. And the only thing cute I had in my home was my cat pajamas. And so many of the first videos on YouTube were all the videos. I made sure to take most of them down, but one happened to continue to survive. And so it remains up as the first cat video on YouTube that's ever been uploaded.
But the music was really good. So where does the music come from?
Yeah, it's Nick Drake that was playing in the background. One of the biggest legal hurdles that YouTube actually encountered. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were many new things as YouTube was becoming bigger and bigger that started catching the eyes of many mm-hmm. people, and especially the music industry in the U.S. You know, you have the Warner Music, EMI, Sony, BMG. Those are rarely big players, and when they saw something like YouTube come along, they didn't know how to respond. They didn't know whether or not we should take
down
this content.
Is it not?
Yeah, because it was really only less than 30 seconds of a cat video with Nick Drake playing in the audio in the background. Mm-hmm. It wasn't edited to put the audio clip in. And so if you actually used, they have these things like Audible Magic, audio signature mm-hmm. Detection algorithms that could detect mm-hmm. that there's anytime there's more than 10 seconds of content, it can automatically figure out that this song belongs to which artist, who has the distribution rights, who has the lyrics mm-hmm. rights. So they could detect that song was not something that I sang, mm-hmm. but something that was by Nick Drake. Mm-hmm. And so one of the reasons that would prevent me from ever trying to capitalize on that first yeah. cat video uh-huh. is audio portion, the audio
I
track.
See.
I don't own the audio track
I
for
see.
It. So for mm-hmm. fair use, for it to stay up, I must either take out the audio or mm-hmm. keep it the way it is.
Right. So if you mint an NFT out of it, then some other music companies may want to take a share.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I see. So you're based in Taiwan now, right? So tell us what you're up to nowadays.
I started my life here. I was born here in Taiwan, mm-hmm. And then I went over to the U.S. when starting in third grade. So as I was, I had just turned 8 years old. And then starting from about in 1999, so right before the dot-com crash, I moved from where I was living in Chicago at the mm-hmm. time to San Francisco in the middle of Silicon Valley to join PayPal. And 1999 to 2019, that whole 20-year period was spent in Silicon Valley mm-hmm. and doing many, many things there, from sort of joining as one of the early software engineers at PayPal to, of course, starting YouTube, going through sort of an acquisition and learning what that process is like to integrate a much smaller company like YouTube into a multinational company like Google. And then even afterwards doing some things with Google Ventures and then doing some sort of angel investing on the side. But after 20 years in Silicon Valley, this was before anything with COVID even mm-hmm. emerged. So mm-hmm. this decision was really made not because of COVID, but wanting to, I think, get a little bit of sense of what this sort of life is outside of what I've been so used to in Silicon Valley. And I think that Silicon Valley still continues to, I think, be at the forefront, certainly when it comes to venture capital, when it comes to fundraising, mm-hmm. when it comes to finding co-founders that have sort of an entrepreneurial spirit that are willing to take risks. But I do think, especially when I was thinking about a broader sense of my family, of my kids, I really wanted them to get a little bit more exposure to the world. And most importantly was, this gets to down to my roots, but I think as an Asian American, I thought that it would still be a little bit shameful if the kids themselves didn't mm-hmm. get some time to be as Asian Americans still living in Asia. And so the original intention of coming to Taiwan was to really be able to get all the entire family, not just myself, but the kids as well, to exposure outside of Silicon Valley. But of course, 6 months after coming to Taiwan and once COVID hit, we were just so grateful at how well handled we were in Taiwan. It was looking at the situation in Silicon Valley where everything was shut down, people were working from home, people not seeing each other for many, many months at a time. We were fortunate that school continued on without doing homeschooling and the offices, we were still able to meet everybody in person every day here. So we've been very fortunate and we still continue to want to extend our stay in Taiwan indefinitely.
Awesome. Yeah, we've never had a lockdown in the yeah. past couple of years. So let's go back a little bit to the beginning, right? So you mentioned that before you started all those startups and participated in the ecosystem, what drew you to computer science and coding in the first place?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it was lucky timing, right? Because at the time when I first started, it was still using these Apple II computers back in the sort of mid to late 80s. You know, I think there was, this was before even, you know, not even static storage drives, but hard drives. This is still on disks that you were barely able to save anything. So you had to really, anything that you had in your mind that you wanted to program, you just had to type out and program, and then once you turn off the computer, everything that you've programmed is going to go away.
I remember that. We're around the same age.
I think that's how I started typing at 120, uh-huh. 130 words per minute, because every weekend you had to retype what you typed last weekend. And I think I've always looked at different studies of engineering, you know, whether it's electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, but when it comes to computer science, which in many schools is part of the College of Engineering, mm-hmm. I've always thought computer science was very different from all the other engineering curriculums insofar as, you're really creating something with your, you have an idea of what you want to accomplish, but as you start typing, it's pretty much your creative mind, and there are so many different ways to be able to get to that same endpoint. Some ways are faster, some algorithms are faster than other algorithms, but more importantly is it's very easy to tell someone that's been in the computer industry for 20 years versus someone that is just entering the industry. They may have the same output with what they've actually developed, what they're actually coding, but when you look at the code itself, sometimes it's elegant and beautiful, like almost like literature or writing. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you look at the code itself, that's how I think computer science differentiates itself from many of the other schools of engineering, in that there's always one correct way of solving many of the engineering questions. But in computer science, I think it starts becoming, when you get to a certain level, it starts becoming not just solving the problem, but how you go on in solving the problem. So I think those early days, when I was just starting out in programming, all you needed was a keyboard, a monitor, and time. And then at the end of a few hours, you have something that you only had in your head, in your mm-hmm. brain. Mm-hmm. It was actually able to be used as an application, and if you did it correctly, it would function correctly. You fix the bugs, and you can show it off to anyone you want. And it's so rapid that you were able to create something, sit down after a few hours, and then have something to show for it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's like composing, right, in a sense, or creative writing, except that the music plays itself.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, very much so. But that's for an individual, right? An individual coder, individual programmer. Mm. But the other thing that happened in 1990 is the World Web and the community, where the coders start to really look at each other's work and reuse a lot of that work. Mm. We've got the free software movement, the open source movement, mm. and everything after. So do you remember those days? Like, how was it like?
Yeah, no, I remember it was using, I think my first introduction to Linux was this Slackware distribution back in, I think, 1993, mm-hmm. 1994. Yep. That was the first time where, growing up earlier, seeing Microsoft and seeing IBM, but the first time where you have open source, you have Linux, you have Linus Torvalds releasing his source mm-hmm. code. And so it's not just the operating system or the applications that you're using, but if you're curious, you can look at for the first time the source code, and if you want, you can modify it and change mm-hmm. things as you see fit. I mean, during those days, this was still, much before the early days of the internet, when it was still very little security, very little mm-hmm. graphics, the World Wide Web, mm-hmm. HTML was just starting out. But all of that was, open standards, open source. And this was available. This was information was available out there anywhere you wanted. I love the times when I was in boarding school, for example, in high school, and I used to stay up all the time till 3 a.m., 4 a.m., and you didn't need anything but, again, a computer with a Ethernet port, and you can access any of the information on the World Wide Web. Mm-hmm. You can download mm-hmm. it, you can read it, you can read the source code behind it. Mm-hmm. There was no class that was teaching you about how to actually use this stuff. This was, for the first time, as long as you had this computer, it was almost having access to all this information all over geographically around the world at your fingertips.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like a worldwide tribe, a real community. Yeah. Yeah. When I started my first startup in 1995, I was blessed to join the Perl community. And I discovered that for each and every internet standard, the way internet works, if I really want to get to the why of it, I can actually read the creators' emails. Right? It's all on public mailing lists. And so not just the kind of legislation for the internet, internet specifications, but rather the legislating process is also very open. And I think it really had a strong influence on my policy making attitude, is to get the not just the what, but the why and how open to the public. So yeah, so when you were founding the small startup called YouTube, do you run it based on Linux or open source free software code?
Yeah, so everything was Linux on the back end. So this was still in when we originally started doing the development in 2005. This was before the what we know as the cloud today was mm-hmm. even started.
Yeah.
So this was before, you know, the Amazon Web Services, the Google Web Services were formed. So at that time, you still had to buy your own racks of machines, figure out how much electricity and power they were going to be taking up, go out physically into the data centers. They may be in different parts around the world, in New Jersey, in San Francisco, and San Jose. And you had to be in the parking lot waiting for the truck to show up, take the, there's mm-hmm. these 42U racks. I mean, they're big racks of machines. You have to roll these machines out of the back of the truck and then install them yourself into your own data center cages. And then you have to figure out the amount of bandwidth you need, the amount of hard drive storage. And this was all still back then, before all the venture capital seed mm-hmm. rounds and Series A rounds that you're seeing, the values of mm-hmm. of what they are today. This was in 2005, where even the top VCs, they were still getting over the dot-com crash. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. there wasn't as much enthusiasm for putting it into these high-risk investments. So a lot of those early days was really trying to figure out exactly optimizing for the dollar spent on our own credit cards. Mm-hmm. And then 4 to 6 weeks later, trying to guess how much YouTube itself was going to grow over a period of 4 to 6 weeks, and then trying to guess how much we're going to be, how many servers we need, how much bandwidth we need, how much hard drive storage we need, and then where do we want to install this? Where in the U.S. do we want to install these machines? If we were deploying YouTube today, it is so much easier. I don't think people mm-hmm. appreciate that. You can just go online, and with a few taps with your finger, you can order 100 machines.
The sheer elasticity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I think back then it was, a very big adventure. I mean, even for us ourselves, today, everybody takes it for granted that something like YouTube could exist on the internet. But the biggest, even when we were pitching the deck to the venture capitalist, to Sequoia Capital, we had to convince them that, and the question for them as well was, could the internet serve as a backbone?
Mm-hmm.
Is there enough bandwidth? Is there enough upload bandwidth? Is there enough streaming bandwidth
download? Would you crash the internet?
Oh yeah, or would people pay for it? Uh-huh. Only a certain, mm-hmm. and you needed broadband you need broadband penetration to be at a certain level to be able to just stream this content. And so people were still doubting whether or not you could use the internet as the backbone rather than all the cables that we've already laid in place for cable mm-hmm. TV. Mm-hmm. Nobody thought that these thin cables that were actually being put in for just emails and web browsing could actually be used as the what's going to eventually take over as the video platform.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So when you were pitching that deck, was it already after you pivoted from being a video dating website, or was it still during the video dating days?
No, the video dating was lasted for about 5 days.
I see.
And zero videos uploaded.
Why is that, I wonder?
It's funny because it took a few years before that story came out about the real story about how YouTube started came out, and that was only because there was a Viacom lawsuit for $1 billion after the acquisition of YouTube by Google. And then it was only under the lawsuit that we had to answer truthfully the question, how did YouTube start? Every time for the 2 years leading up to that was always retelling the story that you've been trained to recite by PR agencies. And I think all internet companies, I really don't...
Yeah, I've been there many times.
I don't think eBay was really about Pez dispensers. I know that PayPal itself was really uh-huh. about doing Palm Pilot security, and then it adapted and evolved mm-hmm. into payments. I think Facebook was really about just dating on campus, and then it mm-hmm. continued to expand. Mm-hmm. That I think is sort of very intrinsic to Silicon Valley startups mm-hmm. is that you know, if you have an idea, I think it's better to get started because nothing, I think, tests the backbone, the validity of the idea better than users themselves. And then you get it out there and you see that, look, nobody's really interested in uploading dating videos on YouTube, but it was a very easy transformation to take. Instead of hearts, you put stars in there for ratings and a few logo changes, but the back end for YouTube, the real-time transcoding of videos, the ability to be able to embed a video into different platforms out there. At the time, it was MySpace, but things like MySpace and Facebook, being able to put that video in those third-party services, that was all kind of built. Whether the end target was for a dating service or for a more generalized platform, the bulk of the time in building that back end, you need to do that regardless of what that app is intended to do. And so I think that's kind of something that we often see as a characteristic of many of these startups that end up being successful. It doesn't matter so much, I think, the especially in the early stages, the seed or Series A stages. To me, it doesn't matter so much what the product is trying to do. Rather, I think it's about the entrepreneurs themselves, whether or not they try to think a little bit outside the box in addressing the problems. And then I think eventually they'll, if you find the right entrepreneurs and the right target markets, they'll eventually stumble upon that solution.
Right, so the initial idea was really just kind of an excuse for the co-founders to meet each other. Right, but if we take that view, that's actually quite different from what people read on those famous accounts of startups, especially when coming out of my PR agency, right? It was always about individuals with brilliant minds that changes the course of history. And so, but from your account, it's more like a group of people just trying out ideas and pivoting all the time. And so it sounds like instead of the usual PR agency story of a single mind with a brilliant idea and so on, what you're actually saying is that it's a group of people in a room working with each other, almost like the first ideas are just there for an excuse for them to know each other and then pivot all the time. Would that be a correct description?
Yeah, I think that especially the earlier you go, earlier in the age of the company, what's more important is not so much the solution to the problem. I think it's important to identify, yes, this is a need that, and this is the important part, is that many, many people have. And in the case of YouTube, it was maybe the solution wasn't right, but the fact that you had a way to be able to kind of utilize the internet, utilize the browser as the back-end platform to be able to both share as well as absorb and watch videos. I think it was more important about what that overall market that you're trying to address. And then I think it's important that the specific entrepreneurs that are solving that, the co-founders of the companies, have that kind of startup spirit to be able to be open to new ideas and to continue to not believe too much in themselves that they're not willing to ever adapt and change. So I think it's you know, the co-founders, they have to have that entrepreneurial spirit, and then I think the target market. But the solution, from what I've seen, it continues to evolve from V1, from pre-seed to seed to Series A. And as you continue to have to evolve and be open to different ideas to address the changes that are coming outside of your control, external to your company.
So a culture of being open for innovation. And you're actually part of another team, the PayPal group, that are very famous for this huge collaborative spirit and being very agile, really. Can you share with us a little bit on how was it like?
Yeah, I think one of the, you know, I've always said that even if the other co-founder, Chad, who happened to be the first designer that designed the PayPal logo, he designed the YouTube logo, and I met when I first went to Silicon Valley. If Chad and I had not spent time in Silicon Valley and specifically at PayPal for about 5-6 years before YouTube was founded, even if we had that idea for a platform to share videos, to be able to upload videos, I don't think we would have had the courage to have taken that first step. I mean, I think that PayPal was instrumental in educating not just Chad and me, but the founders behind Yelp, the founders behind LinkedIn, what Elon's doing right now with Tesla and SpaceX, what Max Levchin and Peter Thiel and all the different funds that are out there that have been formed by many of the early employees at PayPal. I think it was through that period where starting before the dot-com crash with very grand visions, very easy to fundraise, and then all of a sudden, once that dot-com crash hit, the difficulties that are just kind of mounted overnight, it was going to be very difficult to fundraise again. It was going to be, you know, when we were originally there at PayPal, it was so easy to fundraise that we were essentially giving everybody that registered for, you just had to sign in with your email address, your password, and confirm your email address, and we gave you $10.
Yeah, it's called airdrop nowadays.
Yeah, and then if you share it with however many people, here's another $10. Mm-hmm. If you could recruit engineer to work for the company, here's $1,000. I mean, it was expanding so quickly at the cost of Series A funding, Series B funding. But then overnight, that funding you knew was going to stop. And I think that was the period when many of the dot-com companies, even some of the ones that went public, they quickly fell off the market because they just couldn't transform that quickly. And I think that there were a lot of, I think, big courageous decisions made during that period. I mean, things like, again, no longer giving out the $10, making sure that people had to enter so much more information to be able to sign up, starting to charge for transactions when the promise all along was that it was going to be a free payment service. But I think all throughout that period, it slowly was able to inject a sort of a monetization strategy in there and then start charging and starting to be able to grow out organically rather than just paying people to sign up and paying people to refer users. But I think the fundamentals was that that here was a team that eventually built a product that is kind of the equivalent of, I think, the sort of this global payment service that's the largest on the internet. But as talented and gifted as the founding team and the early team members are, none of them had any experience dealing with payments. I think what I learned the most in all the companies that are formed after PayPal from this PayPal mafia group, it is possible if you have, you don't have to be necessarily an expert in that domain to be able to at least plant the seeds for something. And so when we eventually had this idea for YouTube, it wasn't a hindrance for us to say that we don't know much about the video space. Mm-hmm. We just knew that this was something that we would utilize. It's something that hopefully a problem that just not we encountered, but other people would encounter. How do you use this this computer to be able to upload and share
cat videos? Yes, yes, it's a pressing need for humanity. Of course, it is. So, has the pandemic changed the kind of close collaboration you just described with the PayPal mafia? Like for the past couple of years in the Silicon Valley, I understand the way that work is structured is different nowadays. So can you chime in a little bit on that with your observations?
No, fundamentally, I think from the user side, it still seems like the productivity has maintained at the steady pace, and you're still continuing to see from the very top tiered technology companies to startups. They seem to be flourishing regardless of what's been happening with the pandemic over the last 2-3 years. The fundamentals of how the structure of these companies and how people are working in these companies have changed dramatically. Mm-hmm. People in the startups now, many of them have not seen each other except over Zoom. Even from the very interview days to now, they've never met each other in person, and many of them, they're even geographically distributed to the point where with the possibility of working maybe a couple days a week together. Geographically, they can't because they're all over the world. But I think it'll be an interesting period to see what ends up being the long-lasting solution. Because as far as I know, coming from San Francisco, people have gotten used to being able to work at home in their own hours, in their own comfort zone, in whatever dress that they need to wear. And they've found it to be more productive and more welcoming in a lot of ways. And so I think there's definitely both buckets, pros and cons, mm-hmm. in terms of what's going to happen. I think there's still something to be had about being able to collaborate in person. I still think some of the best ideas still come not in a planned format where we say at 6 p.m. we're going to get together three of us online and we're going to brainstorm and come up with the next idea. I still think some of the best ideas still come a little bit randomly during casual periods where you're waiting in line together for the Google cafeteria, where you're mm-hmm. waiting in line for getting a coffee, and you start talking to the person behind you or in front of you, and that's when an idea comes to you, when the light bulb comes off. So I think that I think Silicon Valley, and I think many of the larger companies, I think they'll gravitate towards maybe a mixture of mm-hmm. both to be mm-hmm. able to, I think, capture the productivity that you get from working from home, but still capture some of that innovation that you get when people are together.
But your latest startup is based in Taiwan. So do you work in a hybrid format? Do you have your co-founders or your employees working in a different time zone? How's it structured?
No, so that's one thing where in Taiwan, we've had the fortune of being able to work, and everything is so close that it's within walking distance, the office. So we still meet up every day in person. Wow. And spend mm-hmm. you know, at least 5 to 6 hours all locked in one room. And I think that in a startup, they're really with iPhones, with the fact that you're connected on multiple devices, regardless of where you are, with different ways of interacting real-time, with real-time video, real-time audio, I could say that you're almost working, or at least you're on call 24 hours, mm-hmm, 7 days mm-hmm. a week. I think the time to be able to still be together for at least 5-6 hours during the daytime is something that I think the entire team finds it's helpful to be able to talk and to be able to talk about some of these ideas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely, right? Yeah. And still insist to do old-fashioned stand-ups with people in the same room, even at the height of the pandemic. So I totally relate to what you're saying. Let's talk a little bit more about YouTube, if you're comfortable with that. So do you still watch YouTube? Like a lot or sometimes?
Yeah, and not as just testing the code anymore, right? I know. It's actually enjoying the content.
Drinking your own champagne. Right?
I think it certainly has outperformed any of the initial expectations of a startup that we had in 2005. Back then, I never thought that it would come as far as this. I never thought that, you know, one day I would be, I would have kids that, my own kids that would be using this service. And it would be, when we were creating YouTube, I never thought that this would eventually be the favorite app my kids would be using. And I can tell them at 9 p.m., stop using my app when I want them to turn off YouTube. I think that I think it's become the solution to, I think the internet just needed a platform to be able to share videos. And in one way or another, I think YouTube, the name is synonymous with video distribution on the internet. So if you want your content to be scene. Regardless of how you feel about YouTube and its strategy and Google, there's really no options. You really have to put it onto YouTube in order to be distributed on that YouTube platform. Because if you wanted to be seen anywhere with services, that's the app that people are going to be using when they want to watch and search for content on the internet. It is one of the only apps that that I'm using on a daily basis, all the time. on my iPhone, and it's still sometimes just hard to believe that everything that went along with it. I mean, it was early on, just even when YouTube launched, it was before the iPhone was out, and then getting the calls from the Steve Jobs at the time to say, when we launch the iPhone. All the apps that we're going to have to sell the iPhone, we're going to write in-house in Apple. But there's one third party that we want to work with that will help sell the iPhone, and it's going to be big. It's going to be YouTube. And so they invited Chad and me to go out there into the Cupertino headquarters of Apple to be able to talk about how are we going to, how are we going to work together? We've never worked with this is before any third party could write.
Before App Store.
Before the App Store. This is 6 months before.
There's no app for that.
So we had to, actually the first YouTube app, the first V1 iPhone was written by Apple. We didn't write that because it wasn't available to us, the software development kit. So it was working. It was a Apple-written YouTube, and there was a terms in the contract that after a certain period, we would be able to, we as in Google and YouTube, would regain the rights to write our own version of YouTube. So the first version of YouTube was us supplying Apple with all the videos, but it was actually an application that was written by Apple, the company, rather than any of the software engineers at YouTube.
So that was in Objective-C, I believe.
Yeah.
All right. So there's something that YouTube nowadays, people spend a lot of time on it, partly because of its recommendation system. It will just find the videos that they think that you would engage more time to, right?
Yeah.
And that wasn't the original startup vision of it. So it got added by, of course, Google's huge recommendation system and database. So how do you feel about that?
The secret there was always that this is a little bit dated, but I believe the general numbers are still accurate, right? The at the time that I was there, the average session for a YouTube user was around 28 minutes. Every YouTube user would spend 28 minutes on the service, and this is very proactive. It's not like a typical family room, living room experience where you're watching the TV from afar, but you're there with your face close to the monitor and you're clicking on things because every piece of content is only, on average, 1.5 to 2 minutes in length. Mm-hmm. And even if the content was longer than that, the average viewing time was only 1.5 to 2 minutes because there's so many recommended videos that was going to grab your attention and you're going to keep tapping. So, for the average time of a session being 28 minutes, they're actually watching and actually looking at and searching and browsing and looking at the recommendations a lot of the time to find the next video that they want to watch. And I think many users are surprised when they originally go on to YouTube to start their 28-minute session. It may be one video in this bucket, this island of content. Mm-hmm. But then when they're seeing how they end up the night 28 minutes later, they don't know how they got from this video to this video. And it's because of the recommendation engine. There's a lot of playing around on the positive and negative feedback to that, the AI that was driving the recommendations.
Like the polarization.
Because there's all this stuff about, there's nothing really in there that's trying to actively invoke the user to have to say they like this content and these are related videos. Mm-hmm. Everything was taken on user behavior.
Sure.
Whether they viewed a piece of content for more than 10 seconds would automatically give positive feedback. If it's less than 10 seconds, that means they probably didn't like this video. Mm-hmm. If they're skipping around in the different videos, there was a lot of things that was really interesting. And I think what was most effective with the recommendation engine was actually not so much the contents of the video. So if you happen to like cat videos, mm-hmm. it wasn't just recommending other cat videos or searching for other videos with mm-hmm. the tags or with the titles, cats in it. The most effective way that the AI engine was recommending videos was only looking at what other users mm-hmm. watched. And so, mm-hmm. and that started growing where you'll see that maybe people that like cat videos, a large part of them also like maybe other pet videos. And then you start going from other pet videos to maybe sports videos, kid videos, child videos, music videos. And so it was a lot of the AI that was driving the recommendation engine was just looking at the billions of users that were using the service mm-hmm. and how what they were looking in their 28 minutes of time of their user session time, and then using that as the mm-hmm. the genesis for recommending other videos to other users. And so that was good because we didn't want users to just get stuck watching cat videos for 28 minutes mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. because it had to, I had to do a lot of work to be able to recommend a video that you have never seen before that's related to videos that you've seen before that we think that you're going to be able to click on. And so there was a lot of computation that was being done for that to actually be able to perform that on every time you watch a new video, a whole slew of new recommendations would come up.
Yeah, this year, there's been a kind of gradual movement toward more openness of how exactly that works, like which cohort right, do the algorithm sort me into and things like that. Have you been like paying attention or giving advice on these? I think the technical term is algorithmic transparency, but rather it's just about building trust.
I think a lot of the social platforms, social services out there, mm-hmm. especially in the last few years, I think they're entering a stage in which society at large is starting to question. It's not so much, I think, whether or not they are forced legally to have to share mm-hmm. this, but it's in the best interest because it's going to quell a lot of the curiosity and a lot of the questions that people have about mm-hmm. How are you using my data?
Right. It's decisions about us without us, right?
Yes, without you knowing, yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, so you see it's a kind of generally a more kind of social norm that's evolving to what it is instead of like having to obey a certain piece of legislation, for example.
I mean, I would say that uh-huh. before, I used to do a lot of the customer service emails coming into YouTube and people would be complaining mm-hmm. and I would oftentimes get emails from parents asking, you have to take this content down yeah. because my kids are watching this. Uh-huh. This was before I had kids of my own. I would delete these emails. Because it didn't break any of the copyright mm-hmm. laws. It didn't have copyrighted content, mm-hmm. copyrighted music.
It was not a DMCA takedown.
It wasn't a takedown. So you can't blame us for this piece of content. But I learned a lot after having kids that this is a grave concern to have when you can't control what people are watching, when you have no idea what's going to come up on the recommendations. Mm-hmm. I think YouTube Kids came out to be able to try to do some age restrictions around the content, which was very important. But I think technology always moves so much faster than the law. And so it's difficult at the time we were still using DMCA, which was, mm-hmm. I think, written mm-hmm. in 1997 yeah. as the way to keep YouTube around legally about mm-hmm. the types of content. Mm-hmm. And if you have copyrighted content, write us or fax us a takedown.
That's right.
And then we'll take it down in 3 to 7 days. It is outdated for where the technology is. And so I think fortunately, I didn't have to be there in 2011 when I left YouTube to have to deal with it. But that was always one of the biggest fears I had was when the technology companies are no longer there just to make the technology decisions, but they have to make a decision about things like fake news and things like who's deciding this? There's nothing legally that says you have to take this mm-hmm. down, mm-hmm. but your users want you to do something. And there's no law, there's no precedent to follow. You have to mm-hmm. you have to define this yourself. And so when you're at the forefront, when you're at Facebook and Instagram and YouTube and Google, you have to make these decisions about what things you keep up, what things you take down. Twitter with Donald Trump, what to, it's hard to decide what to do. And I think it's just about any decision you make, you're taking sides and you're always going to have supporters as well as people that are going to be refusing to continue to use your platform.
Yeah, in Taiwan, and putting on my digital ministry hat, we try to set a standards ourselves in the government responding to the social norms. So, for example, the example you just given around election, for example, our campaign donation, finance, and everything, there's a Sunshine like Transparency Act, and we do publish those as open data for all investigative journalists to see like where the money comes from and so on. So with that norm set by the people, social sector, we can then turn to those large platforms and say, at least in our jurisdiction, at least in Taiwan, to do what we already do, right? Because otherwise, people can just pay to circumvent fact-checking by targeting advertisement in a way that's outside of our jurisdiction and very difficult to trace. And so I believe that kind of worked because the operators in this region, for example, in our jurisdiction, seem to see that if they do not conform to our local norm, there's a real chance of social sanction, right?
Yeah.
But is that enough? Or do you have other suggestions for me?
Maybe I have a question for you because I think I disagreed when YouTube and Twitter made some of these decisions, which was, look, we believe that any videos that says that vaccines, you must take vaccines, and if you're saying anything that's anti-vaccine, we're going to take that content down and potentially ban your account. I don't know if YouTube or Twitter should be making those decisions about how to communicate to the 2 billion people out there, how they're supposed to adopt vaccines in their own family and personal lives.
Right, so it's like kind of over-centralizing the decision-making powers. What's the alternative? Like, how else would they do it?
I mean, I think this is putting a lot of that responsibility back onto the users and the viewers themselves. But it's if you have a completely open platform where you have both views, you have the pro and anti-vaccine content, is it responsible for the server, for the service providers, for YouTube to say, we're going to keep all this content up and it's up to you to decide when you watch these content, which ones you're going to believe in, which ones you're not? I think historically, it's always been veering towards this latter description of we're going to keep as much content that legally we're able to keep up. Whether it's fake or not, we're not going to make the decision.
As a parent.
But as a parent, you start saying, okay, well, that's not right. But then how, you know, I guess it's how far do you go back to, okay, this is 100% aligned with what I believe in and my political views, but I mean, again, something that we saw early on at the YouTube days was it was most of the content was left-leaning in terms of politics. And so we had to put up a lot of content, even though the total number of views and the total number of uploads weren't there, as I was the one that was choosing on a daily basis and selecting the 10 recommended videos that we would put on the front page of YouTube.
Wow, it was picked by hand.
At first. Well, I mean, at that time, we actually saw it was kids dancing and pets videos that were actually getting the most views. But in my mind at the time, it was a little bit about educating the users what YouTube could be used for. So a lot of the times, it wasn't exact a one-to-one correlation. Just because these were the 10 most popular, most viewed videos of the day, most likely they were not going to make it to the recommended videos on the front page, because a part of me was trying to educate the users to say, we already know it's a platform that you're going to be able to watch music, you're going to be able to watch comedy, you're going to be able to watch pets and kids videos, but I bet you didn't know that you could use this platform for distributing news in Africa. You can distribute anything you want as long as you had this video in your pocket saved somewhere. You uploaded it to YouTube, and all of a sudden, you solved the problem of anyone in the world being able to access that piece of content in your pocket. You know, but I think a lot of those early days was also choosing content that was from the right parties, was from the Republican parties, putting that up onto YouTube in a way to educate the entire masses that this is an open platform that's not towards, that doesn't have any political alignment. This is neutral as we can be. But that took a coordinated effort because really on the back end, that wasn't the case.
Right, so it sounds like curation or something out of a newspaper editor, something like trying to balance the different political views.
Yeah.
And out of that impulse, let's say, of neutrality for the vaccination things, what I understand is that for a while, YouTube has been experimenting by a kind of public notice, right? When it detects a video is trying to say something, then it links to on a very very easy to note format, Encyclopedia Britannica or Wikipedia that says, well, this is what the encyclopedia says.
Yes.
How would you like that as a parent?
I think it certainly makes an advancement towards we're going to be completely steering away from it. Because, while the law, and this comes back to the copyright and DMCA, while the law doesn't say as an internet service provider what you need to communicate, what you need to say to your users, it's the expectations of the users or the parents of the users are that you have to do something because this is the platform that our kids are using for hours at a time, and we have no way of being able to see exactly what they're viewing. But I think that this has always been especially since 2011, after I've left with a lot of, on the political side of things and a lot with on what's happening with COVID, is it's a hard problem to really solve and trying to make everybody happy in this this process,
right? Yeah, maybe not happy, but at least live with it.
Yeah.
Instead of rage quitting.
Yeah.
So another thing that we've learned during our counter disinformation efforts is that kids that are participating more, for example, as fact checkers or as YouTubers themselves who produce content, tend to be kind of less polarize in the sense that they understand a little bit how the platform works instead of just blindly following the recommendation engine. So I don't know, how would you feel like if your kids tell you they're going to become YouTubers, an influencer economy, how would you respond or support them?
No, I mean, I think even listening to that point, I think that the importance of having a parent or a guardian being able to, I think, stand outside of that ecosystem and be able to still advise and instruct and teach a bit. Because, you know, I think if left on its own, you would let your kids' education be completely dominated by the Facebook recommendation engine or the YouTube recommendation engine. And the deeper you go into a certain opinion or certain side of a of any political debate, any argument, it's just going to keep recommending more videos. It's not within its algorithm to recommend a completely different video that you're not going to like that perspective, that opinion. So I think that there always still somehow needs to be this integration of something outside of the system, outside of that entire ecosystem of recommendation engines, to be able to try to shift this so the perspectives aren't so polarized, and then this job of being a YouTuber is it was a new thing. And
well, thanks to you.
I think the monetization to be able to do it, I think it's really interesting in that it's in a positive light, is that it allows and it encourages everyone of all ages, but especially kids, if they have a certain interest and if they have certain passions that they develop, I think at least there's an outlet for it now, that it's not automatically, if there was prior to YouTube, if there wasn't a very observable, notable job that you could take doing this as a full-time employment, there would be a lot of discouragement from pursuing this. But at least with YouTube, you're going to always be able to find other people from all over the world that's going to be connected, that's going to share and going to, you know, thumbs up these, mm-hmm. these videos that you create. So I think in one light, mm-hmm. or from one perspective, I think that that's great that that creates the sort of positive note mm-hmm. on things. Mm-hmm.
So you tell your kids that's great. And
on the other hand, a lot more exciting to be, I think, doing what Daddy did. Go create the platform. Try to see what's going to be maybe, I don't know what that solution is, but what is next after YouTube? Mm. Or what is, I think there's still something to be said about, you know, like spend that creativity to think like where else is the, what is the next generation of how we're going to be, you know, sharing and exploring and learning mm-hmm. new things? Just how are we going to embody content in the next generation mm-hmm. and somehow build that and let other mm-hmm. people create that content?
I just think more about the future, not just the present, or how the code defines the present. Anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, yeah, I think it's a great view. Mm. So to the future then. So you're running a startup. And so in Taiwan, mm. and you mentioned that they're all in the same room, all of you, mm. for 5 hours or 6 hours a day. So how's it like? And how would you rate Taiwan startup scene for hosting? Of course, we've got this counter-COVID angle where you can actually spend 6 hours in the same room. But what other support systems that you find good or bad? What should we be doing more and so on?
No, I think this has been starting something in Taiwan wasn't the original intention for this trip coming mm-hmm. out to, mm-hmm. to Taiwan. The original journey started in just being able to want to transplant and have a different entire sort of life experience. But always in the back of my mind, ever since even coming back to Taiwan, starting from like 2006, mm-hmm. 2007, 2008, every time we did a talk, a panel discussion, one of the first questions that would always come up was that there are so many of these Taiwanese-American entrepreneurs from Silicon Valley, mm-hmm. more so than, you know, Japanese-American, mm-hmm. Korean-Americans. Mm-hmm. A disproportionate amount of these entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley are all Taiwanese-American mm-hmm. that are coming up with their own ideas, entrepreneurs, and taking the risks to go fundraise to take these ideas. Yet in Taiwan, the opposite seems to be true, that there's a lot of companies that have been successful coming out of Singapore, more mm-hmm. have been emerging yep. out of South Korea. Yep. But Taiwan itself, I mean, I'm going to take away the semiconductor mm-hmm. industry, and I think in the last 15, 20 years, mm-hmm. in terms of the software consumer space, there just has only been a trickle of companies that have had the sort of vision of doing something on the global landscape mm-hmm. in mind from day one. And that was always the question. And I think many people, when they ask that question, they themselves have a little bit of some of an inkling of ideas of why that is. Maybe it's the, you know, the education system is different. And then of course, you know, when it comes to fundraising, the spirits of an mm-hmm. entrepreneur, the overall model of, you know, language and communications. And then of course, I think just being physically in an island in Taiwan mm-hmm. versus if you're there in Silicon Valley, you know, we were able to, again, meet with Jerry Yang from mm-hmm. Yahoo and then mm-hmm. Google multiple times and then do the entire sale of YouTube to Google, all compressed within 5 days. Now, that's just going to be difficult regardless of where you are and how talented the entrepreneurs are if you're not in Silicon Valley. But I think coming back here to Taiwan, when I finally moved back here, I was very curious to really see kind of firsthand if we try to employ all the same strategies and tactics that we've used in companies in Silicon Valley, mm-hmm. what's going to work and what's not going to mm-hmm. work. And then in other ways, just to be able to firsthand know what is it that's different about mm-hmm. starting a company
like
in Taiwan.
A/B testing. Yeah.
Well, at the high level, I think Taiwan's not lost. I think at the high level, there's still plenty of opportunity and potential for global companies to come out of Taiwan. Really, as if we were trying to create a company in Silicon Valley for the global market. I think it is possible to do from Taiwan, but over the course of the last year, trying to do it myself, one, I found myself almost exploring this much of this journey without a lot of predecessors in front to follow. It doesn't seem that there have been that many attempts from day one for entrepreneurs just to say, forget the first version being the test market in Taiwan, and then if it's successful, we'll translate this and then we'll expand this to the regions outside of Taiwan. There weren't many companies that just from day one, we're going to launch this service for the world, just like what we did at YouTube. And if it becomes popular within Taiwan, that's a byproduct of a successful global product. So many of these things, when it comes to establishing the company, when it comes to starting to do fundraising and you need entities in Delaware, you set up LLCs and C-Corps to be able to take in the fundraising, to be able to really have a good sense of addressing the problems with the right solutions that you're trying to address with the consumer applications. It is, it's not the execution ability, right? It's not the ability to be able to find the right engineers and the right product managers and the right UI UX designers. That's very competitive and difficult to find in Silicon Valley. I think the quality of all those individual contributors in Taiwan are at the same quality as what you can find and as what you can find in Silicon Valley. But I think the hard part is trying to find the people that have a sort of an intimate knowledge of what it's like to be that target user. So and that's the biggest learning challenge so far has been, it's difficult to create a global startup here in Taiwan if the users people behind if the founding team, especially behind the product, may not actually be the target end user. It's hard to encourage them to think outside the box, and it's hard to tell them to come up with creative ideas for a problem that they themselves don't face. And so I think that what's been exciting with the Gold Card program and the last few years with many people coming back to Taiwan from all over the world is that there's been this kind of injection of just culture,
microcosm,
right? And I think that I really think that that was a missing element that is critical to be able to create startups from anywhere around the world. Is that, you know, the teams, the people that are coming up with these solutions, they have to have a good sense of what it's like to be the end user of these applications. And and I think Taiwan overall, I think, could benefit more. Similar to what Singapore and Israel have done, where they've established many bridges to have many of the C-level execs of their startups residing permanently in Silicon Valley while the rest of the teams are still in their respective countries. They would have Zoom calls on a regular basis, and they would fly back and forth all the time. They would have offices in those areas to be able to have gather-togethers with all the Singaporean entrepreneurs that are in Silicon Valley on a regular basis to be able to coordinate and help one another out. I think that there's some more things that can be done to be able to close that gap between a lot of the individual contributors here in Taiwan with the larger community on the global scenes.
Do you test your pilot ideas or prototypes with the expat or the go-kart community?
Well, I mean, it's been critical to be able to have these get-togethers. I mean, especially last year where it was it really felt during the peak of the COVID period that Taipei was almost transformed into a Silicon Valley.
I know. A lot of my Silicon Valley friends are, like, literally here.
You know, every night that you would go out, it would be the same group that you would actually... It felt like there was no change from the years before living in Silicon Valley, except you can't read the street names, right? But I think that... you know, it's, I think that was a, and I wish that, you know, we, or Taiwan can take advantage of that more. It was, I think there's so much of that that came in, and it wasn't pre-planned that this was going to happen, but all of a sudden there's all these, and just to be able to pack up your bags and leave and come to Taiwan usually means that you've done something already in the past that allows you the freedom and liberty to be able to do this. And so to be able to take advantage of that, to be able to encourage them, these entrepreneurs coming in that have done something else in the past around the world to do something to plant their seeds here.
Yeah, I think the Ministry of Science and Technology actually said if you work to run a startup, you're automatically eligible for the gold card, right? So which is great. But I think last June-ish, right, when Taiwan had our first real wave of alpha variant, of course, we squashed that in like 3 months or so. Yeah. But during those 3 months, I understand a lot of people just went back. May I ask very directly, why did you stay?
Well, I think that out of the people that applied for the gold card, I think there were really two buckets, right? I think there's one, and unfortunately, I think it was the much larger bucket, was people that were escaping from the U.S. And they were looking at anywhere in the world that was going to be safer, that allowed them the ability to be able to venture outside, to be able to live the life that they had before 2019, 2020. For me and the family, I mean, we came to Taiwan again before COVID started, and we had always wanted to be in Taiwan, I guess, with or without COVID, and we only considered a benefit that Taiwan has performed so well unexpectedly when we came with COVID that we've always said, you know, this, it, I think it just remains unchanged that our goal and our intention was always to plant and then grow the seeds here. So even during that period when we left, it looked like the situation was starting to get, it was starting to stabilize and starting to improve back in the U.S. And it was a period during the beginning of last summer when things were a little bit more chaotic in Taiwan without a very good idea of what that...
Yeah, we had to invent a new contact tracing system in 3 days.
but always the intention was come the start of the new school year, we're going to be back in Taiwan regardless of the number of cases.
So you're pre-committed in a sense. Yeah. So how are your kids finding Taiwan? I understand they're here with you. So do they speak Mandarin?
We'll delay that question for another year or two, you know.
I see. They will, I guess.
It's, now I mean, you know, to whoever's listening to this that has some thoughts, maybe a probability about moving to Taiwan, especially if you have young kids, I would really say give it a shot.
You know?
It's, especially I think for a family, and in fact, I think especially for the family, rather than as an individual, I think when you really consider the whole gamut, the whole spectrum of the needs of a family, including raising the kids in a safe environment, raising the kids in an open environment, and then having the possibilities and having everything being so close and the sort of the family ties being that intimately tied to one another, Taiwan's been just a surprise to even me how well it serves the family needs. A lot of the time when we first moved to Taiwan in 2019, it was a bit of wanting to explore Asia and getting into Taiwan, but not, maybe this is the startup spirit, not knowing exactly what we were getting into. But I think since that period, it's all been sort of positive with the, with, and I think it's not just for me, but I think for the entire family as a whole. And even through every summer that we've been back to the U.S. to visit old friends and to visit the Bay Area as well as other places in the U.S., in the back of my mind, I'm still always comparing, contrasting between Taiwan and wherever we are. And I would say that, just about every box, you know, it's checked where Taiwan's a better place for doing whatever it is that we want to be doing with the family.
Yeah, including, I understand, a basketball yard in the social innovation lab within walking distance, which happens to be my office.
the amount of time that's compressed, I think having spent all my sort of childhood growing up in different parts of the U.S., but I'm going to say, while I haven't lived everywhere in the U.S., having been and lived in many different parts of the U.S., I can probably with some, high level of confidence say that nowhere in the U.S. can you just fit as many of the activities and as full days as you could in Taiwan. And just everything is so convenient and so easy, so reachable and accessible and so safe. It doesn't matter if you're in Chicago or San Francisco or LA or Hawaii. It's just difficult to be able to do as much as you can, to be able to go across the street, to be able to play basketball, to be able to walk down to work without needing a car. Right?
Yeah, I'm now thinking that Taiwan Plus may need a Taiwan for Kids section just to host the content that you just described. So my last question, what do you think is coming up over the horizon in terms of innovation and new ideas this year?
I think there's there's a lot of interesting exploration on the frontiers of what can be done in the whole entire metaverse, entire Web3 space. And I think some of them are maybe a little bit more valid. Some of them I would invest in, some of them I would not.
Reminds me of the dot-com boom days.
Yeah, exactly. But I do think that what's going to emerge and come out of the Web3 is going to still be things that we still haven't thought of yet. I mean, it's that groundwork that's been laid down, that's been made with some real tangible products making it seem possible to do this. I think it's going to be an exciting period for the next few years to see what's going to come out of this, out of the entrepreneurs' minds. Mm-hmm.
So maybe not for dating, but for cat videos.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you, Steve, for joining us today. And to our listeners, please check more information and videos on our YouTube channel on TaiwanPlus.com too. And if you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. See you next time. Live long and prosper.
I think this was quite an experience and unique, different from all the different interviews I've ever done, not just in Taiwan, but ever, right? Of course, I've read a little bit about Audrey beforehand, and I know about her history and her past, but it's not every day, like during the interview that came up, where she would know on the computer science side, some of the things that happened in the 1980s and the 1990s, kind of the same history of how I came into using the computers in the first place, the programming languages, the Linux operating systems. It's very rare during an interview you can talk about these things and the other person would understand. So I think I was really looking forward to this, to be able to see that there's someone like her that's kind of that I would have the opportunity to be able to talk to, but that's also kind of in a leading role for sort of the future of Taiwan. I think because it was more conversational, right? I think most of the interviews are just usually just Q&A, and then the questions are already written up and then you have a few minutes to answer. But this way it felt more conversational. So I think during the first part of the interview, many of those questions are almost memorized responses because they always come up in every one of the interviews or every one of the talks that you give. But as you start getting into as we started getting more in depth into, I think you start talking about after 2011, how the YouTube content was actually, how it should be treated, what should be taken down, and not just YouTube, but Twitter, Facebook, and how it should be doing even things like content that's anti-vaccine. This is usually stuff that during interview training at Google, you don't talk about openly. And so I think in a more conversational a setting like this, and these answers and these conversations actually surface for the first time that they often don't do in any of the other more formal discussions and interviews. This, whether or not I'm the first guest or not, I think this whole environment is new for me. I think there's about like a 50 pairs of eyes or something on what looking at what I'm saying right now. I think that's all new, regardless of whether or not I'm the first one on this show itself. But I think that especially that, as I understand it, the, you know, with the target audience being not just Taiwan, but outside of Taiwan, I think that's exactly what I'm trying to do on the startup side of things, right? On the sort of encourage other people here from Taiwan to think more broadly than just the 23, 24 million people here in Taiwan, but really focus on the 7-8 billion people outside of Taiwan. And I think that it comes over easily, not just with ideas and startups, but I think with all sorts of media, including this one. I think it's important to be able to broadcast this message outside of Taiwan rather than just focusing on Taiwanese people. Well, similar to I think what I said before, I think that to be able to have that channel from inside Taiwan to be able to broadcast to a worldwide audience that are curious, that want to learn, that want to just to grow their knowledge of Taiwan, I think Taiwan can do a lot more in this area to be able to harness that. And I think TaiwanPlus is a great example. Hi, I'm Steve Chen. See you on TaiwanPlus.